If you missed the first part of this story, make sure you look in the description or on the screen. There should be a card for you to catch up. Just figured I would let you know so you don't start halfway through. When I finally awoke from my chemically induced sleep, I couldn't move my arms or legs. Not like they were paralyzed, I just couldn't move because I was held down. Nor could I see anything. My head was pounding with each breath I took as I desperately tried to make out anything about where I was. I wasn't moving, so we weren't still on the road. I started to pay more attention to the sounds and made out the sound of an air conditioner or a heater running. I came to the conclusion that I was already in a house. I started trying to see if there was any way I could untie my legs or feet, but they had me tied in so many places I literally couldn't move an inch. Even my breathing was restricted due to how tight I was bound. I was afraid to make any sound. I knew if they heard me, they would come in. But I also wondered if I screamed loud enough if anyone outside would hear me and be able to help. I was still going over my options when I heard multiple sets of footsteps walking by outside of whatever room I was in. They stopped outside the door and I heard them talking to each other. Though I couldn't make out what they were saying, it was obvious they were both men. I was silently hoping they would just walk away and give me a little more time to decide on what I was going to do. Not my lucky day. I heard the doorknob twist and the creaking of the hinges as the door was opened. I saw a little light start entering the room and I closed my eyes and pretended to be unconscious.
"You awake?"
I sat there silent, not sure if I should answer.
"Are you awake?"
I heard the sound of a light switch and I see it get brighter through my eyelids. I still don't dare open my eyes. I heard one of them walk toward me when I felt an incredible pain in my chest. I couldn't help but scream as my eyes shot open and I tried in vain to get myself loose. Both of the men wore the same mask as everyone in the van. Such a creepy mask with nothing but black eyes and a fold in the fabric that looked like a mouth. The guy that was checking if I was awake lifts his mask and smiles at me.
"Candace is quite fond of you. I don't see what she sees in you. You look weak to me. Are you weak?"
Doing my best to put on a brave face, I say,
"Why don't you untie me and we find out?"
He laughs.
"This should be fun,"
he says as he cuts the ropes holding me down. Once he's severed the last bit holding me down, he steps back as I sit up. He pulls his mask back down over his face and starts whistling. The sound of more people making their way to the room starts to accompany his whistling. As soon as a fifth masked person walks in, he stops whistling and says,
"Time to prove you aren't weak. Follow me. And don't try to run. You won't get far."
At this point, I really don't have many options. These people have already shown that they will end someone's life without a second thought. I started following him as the rest of them turned as I walked by, making sure to be all facing me as I left the room. Once I made my way through the entryway, they all fell in line behind me as I was led down the hall and through a kitchen. I tried looking out any window I could to find out anything about where I was, but I couldn't see anything through the windows. They were either completely covered, or it was too late in the night by now to see anything. We stop at a door leading out of the kitchen, and before opening it, the man leading us turns to me and says,
"A little tip. Don't hesitate. It will make it much easier."
I was still trying to understand what he meant by that when the door was flung open, revealing another dark room. He stepped aside and the rest of the group following shoved me in the room and slammed the door. I heard the click of a lock and was then blinded by the lights being turned on. As my eyes adjusted, I noticed the room I was pushed into looked almost identical to a torture chamber you would see in a movie. The walls were covered in different tools to inflict pain, from a hammer to a drill, all the way to a corkscrew. That was the first thing I noticed. The second was the draped table in front of me. It had the very distinct outline of a person. I was almost too afraid to see who was under the sheet, but at the same time I was afraid it may be one of them playing possum. I grabbed a hatchet from the closest wall and slowly made my way to the table. With my free hand, I reached out to grab the sheet. I yanked it hard and stood in shock at who was laying in front of me. It was Jason. He still hadn't moved at all or made a sound, so fearing the worst, I checked for a pulse. To my relief, I found one. I immediately started slapping him in the face and calling his name. I tried to see if there was any way I could release him, but he was being held down by chains as opposed to the rope I had been restrained with. I started looking around to see if there was anything I could get him free with on the walls. Anything that was available would take a long amount of time to cut through even one set of the chains. I run back over to Jason and do what I can to wake him up. The lights turn off and I hear the sound of the door being unlocked and opened. I turn just in time to see a silhouette enter the room and the door close behind it, leaving us once again in darkness. The lights come back on and I see Candace in front of me. "Candace, what the fuck is going on?" I frantically ask as I start towards her. She pulls a gun and aims it right at my face. I freeze. "There are two ways you leave this room, Randy. One way is walking with us. The other is carried by us. You decide which one of those it'll be with your next decisions. Your friend will wake up soon, but that doesn't change what we expect from you. You need to prove to them you're not weak. You need to take a life to save yours. The next time one of us comes in this room, there better be only one person alive." With that, the lights turn off, the door opens, and I see her leave the room and hear it lock again. The lights turn on and I am once again lost in my thoughts. Does she mean I have to kill Jason? No way in hell I'm doing that. But if I don't, we both die. I had no idea what to do. Was I even capable of murder? Did I have any other options? As I'm trying to answer these questions in my head, Jason starts to moan and shift on the table. I go to him and start talking to him. "Jason, Jason, wake up." He opens his eyes and looks at me. His eyes go wide as he sees the hatchet and he starts screaming, "Randy, what the fuck are you doing? Let me go. You don't have to do this." I tell him it isn't me that put us there and that we're both victims. "Sure we are. Let me out of here then. Let's go get help," he says while struggling to free himself. I walk around to see if there's anything I might have overlooked to cut him free. As I'm frantically searching for anything to free Jason, I start hearing a shuffling coming from outside the door. It reminds me that any second these people could walk in and Jason and I would be dead. I start to wonder if the only way out of this is to kill my friend. How would I live with myself? What would even happen to me if I did kill him? It isn't like I trust these people. But as crazy as it sounds, I was actually considering killing my friend. I was thinking that it was the only chance that even one of us had a chance to get through this and escape. As my mind's spinning and I'm deciding what to do, I heard a slam on a door outside further in the house, and I knew my time was running out. I had to make a decision. This was literally my do or die moment. I walked back over to Jason and told him that I was so sorry for what I had to do. I tried to explain to him that I was being forced or we would both die. Tears start streaming down both of our faces as he starts begging for me not to hurt him, and I begged for his forgiveness. I could hear heavy footsteps making their way to the kitchen and start through it. My heart started beating a million times per second as I raised the hatchet above my head. God help me, my plan was to hit him as hard as I could in the head to make it as painless as possible for him. The footsteps were at the door now. My senses were on high alert as I heard someone grab the handle. Oh my God, this is it, I thought to myself as I closed my eyes and swung down with everything in me. The sound of Jason's scream being cut off by the sickening pop of his skull will haunt me as long as I live. As will what happened next. Just as I thrust the hatchet down, the door slammed open and to my utter disbelief and horror, I hear, "Police! Drop the weapon and get on the ground!" I open my eyes and see Jason's face split in two and I lose it. My grip releases from the handle and I collapse to the floor sobbing. The police are still yelling at me to get on my face and I somehow manage to do that. I am handcuffed and then brought to the police cruiser, then asked where my friends were. I told them my friend is dead on that table in there. They tell me they want to know where my other friends are. I inform them that the people who kidnapped me were in there last I knew, but we were not friends. I am put in the back of the car and left in my own mind with the occasional question from an officer. Not long after, I'm brought back to the all-too-familiar interrogation room and questioned more than I ever thought possible before I am told that I was being placed under arrest for the murder of Jason as well as Sarah. I tried to explain that it wasn't me, that I was kidnapped by other people. They told me that unless I could tell them where to find my supposed kidnappers, or more than a first name and a now disconnected number, then it was a conversation that I should have with my lawyer, and I was booked and put in a cell, That brings us to current day. I pled not guilty to all the charges I'm facing, but I'm currently locked up awaiting trial. My bond is set so high my family can't afford to pay it. So from what I'm told, I could be here for years before even seeing a courtroom. Being in here, I have a lot of time to think about how bad everything looks against me. After my 911 call, police rushed to my apartment to find me gone. After the boxes being left on my doorstep, they had talked to the apartment owner and he agreed to let them hide cameras that watched the walkways. They went and reviewed the recordings to see if they could find anything from the time that I called. What they did see were two masked men walk up to Jason's apartment, then use the same rag technique they use on me to knock him out, just an hour before my 911 call. From there, they loaded him into the same van they took me in and drove off. Unfortunately, the cameras couldn't get a view of the license plate and the police had no other leads to locate the van. By dumb luck, one of the neighbors of the vacant home, the one I was actually found in, called to complain about someone being in the house late at night. Driving up, the police saw the van in the driveway and called for backup before coming to the door. Candace and her family must have seen them because they were gone by the time the officers came to make entry. The police came in just as I struck Jason, so they personally witnessed that and I was being held accountable. What's worse is the van ended up being stolen and had no fingerprints. Police assume I stole it before murdering Sarah since it got reported as stolen that night. Pretty much, I am screwed. There is no light at the end of my tunnel. Even if they did believe me, I did end Jason's life, so I'm guaranteed going to be sitting in here a long time. They think that it was actually a group of me and my friends who did this, and that I won't turn any of my friends in. This whole ordeal feels like one insane dream that I just can't wake up from. What's worse, I got a letter in the mail today. I opened it and saw a simple drawing, the same one I had found when I opened the package from my doorstep. I gave it to my attorney and told him it was the same design, but he said it really won't do anything for my case. To be honest, I'm not exactly sure why I'm sharing this story. Everyone always claims to be innocent. They come up with elaborate stories to cover their backs. Unfortunately, this crazy one just happens to be true. I guess I'm telling this so you can know my story, so that you know that true evil is still out there walking amongst you, and killing you isn't the worst thing they can do. Hey, thanks for listening to this video. And if you want to see the inspiration for this story, make sure you check the link in the description, as well as the comments, as well as a card that's going to be on the screen at some point. This story was inspired by the series on CryptTV called Sunny Family Cult. And if you haven't checked it out, I highly recommend you go check it out. They have an extremely large quantity of horror content that will be right up your alley. And it's all done in a TV quality format. I highly recommend you go check it out. Like right now. Because you're not doing anything else. This video's over, so you should go check it out and subscribe. Show them some love. Thanks again, everybody, for listening to this. I really appreciate it. And I hope you enjoyed this story. Well, the few stories that I've done. And make sure you checked all those out, too, because this is the third video I've done. And I quite enjoyed it. I hope you did as well. I will catch everybody in the next video. And just remember to watch your back, because you never know who or what is watching you. Police! Get on the weapon and drop the ground! Drop the ground? Police! Get on the weapon!
Get on the weapon and drop the ground, fool!
Alright, alright, this one's for real.